Told it is to make a measurement. The purpose of significant figures is to tell me how much guesswork was involved in my measurement. If I'm looking at this one in ones, 31, 32, 33, right, it's between, there's 32.1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? So that's 32.12 for sure. It's somewhere between 32.2, 3, 3, 3, 3. That's what they're approximating, right? So we're confident it's 32.3. And then it's somewhere between 0.3 and 0.4. So that last value is the one that's estimated, always. Here, this one's in tens, right? So I'm guessing it's like 32. But I might look at that and think it's 32.3. You might look at it and think it's 32.5, right? That last digit is always the one that's approximated. So which value has the more highly confident units? It's obviously the first one, right? So significant figures tell the reader how accurate is the piece of equipment that I'm using. Is there a lot of guesswork involved or is there no guesswork involved? If I'm measuring volume using a beaker, beakers are really sloppy, right? They're measured in tens, 20s, 25s, depending on the beaker. There's a lot of guesswork here, right? It could be 20, it could be 22. Who knows, right? There's no calibration between 20 and 40. There's just one little tick mark. But who knows? If I'm using something like a graduated cylinder, that's got significantly less guesswork, right? Because it's ticked off every one. And then when we use burettes, those are calibrated in 0.1s, right? So the less guesswork is involved in your measurement, the more accurate it is. And that's the purpose of using significant figures, is to tell others, how accurately did I make my measurement? What piece of equipment was I using? Because for us as chemists, the piece of equipment dictates the accuracy. And since this class is an empirical class, right? We're basing it on data, we're measuring things. We want to be making those measurements really, really well, right? We don't want to be making lousy measurements. We want to be making good measurements. So we use significant figures to tell other people, how accurate was I in making my measurements? Make sense? All right, so we have to use some rules to figure out how many significant figures are in a measurement. These are rules that you're just gonna have to commit to memory. And they're gonna be a little clunky at first. It'll take some practice. Now, I will tell you that the first three rules are easy. So any non-zero digit is significant. If it's a number between 1 and 9, it's a significant digit because it's not a zero. That's the sheer reason that it makes it significant. So this number, 112.1, has 4 sig figs. I call them sig figs for short. Significant figures, a lot of letters to write out. Right? Sig figs is cute and it's short. So all 4 of those are significant figures because they are not zeros. By definition, if it's not a zero, it's significant. Now, a zero that's sandwiched in between non-zero digit is significant. Right? So these are non-zero digits. There's a zero stuck in the middle. This number has 3 sig figs. Because this zero is sandwiched in between non-zero digits. Same is true with this one. These zeros are sandwiched in between non-zero digits, so therefore this measurement has 4 sig figs. So the first two rules are pretty easy. I think I said the first 3. First 2 are the easiest. Everybody good on rules 1 and 2? I see a lot of writing, so I'll try to pace myself so that you're not trying to write and listen at the same time. Okay. When things get messy is when zeros come into the picture. So zeros to the left of a non-zero digit are not significant. Zero to the left, not significant. Not. Why? Let's look at this measurement. When I go to my balance over there and I put something on it, this would be a very small mass, right? 0.0023 grams. That's a small mass, yes. Okay, why are these zeros insignificant? Because these zeros are just placeholders, okay? That's not an actual measurement. That's not an actual measurement. These two digits are what's actually been measured. You could imagine, if you want, the little underscore, you know, the underscore mark on your keypad, right? Underscore, underscore. That's just a placeholder. We don't like having an empty spot, right? There has to be something to hold the spot. So if you want to imagine that as an underscore instead. These are insignificant. They're not actually measured. What did I measure? I measured this. And then any estimated digits would be beyond this, right? This is where the measurement actually begins. These are just placeholders. And also, when you write this in scientific notation, look, those leading in zeros go away, right? So that's emphasizing even further that this is the measurement, not this. So this number has two significant figures, not four. It's a really common mistake. And then here's another one using more zeros. What's actually being measured? It's this one, not all these zeros, right? Those are just placeholders. Again, think of the little underscore. If you want to think of those as a little underscore instead, as a placeholder, that's actually what's being measured, not that. Are we good on rule number three? Okay, rule number four. Zeros to the right are significant if a decimal is present. If a decimal is present. There must be a decimal for those zeros to the right to be significant. Must be a decimal. So for instance, this value, 1.200, these zeros are actually being measured. Those are actual measurements. They're not placeholders. Because think about it, what are they holding the place of? They're not holding the place of anything. They are actual measurements, okay? So if you ask yourself, could this value be replaced with an underscore? Here the answer is no, right? Because I put this on the balance and the balance says 1.200. That means that this tenths place is a measurement and it just happens to be zero. This hundredths place is a zero. This thousandths place is a zero. And they just happen to be zeros, right? Those values are significant. They are actual measurements. Zeros to the right are significant if a decimal is present. This one gets students a lot. And then zeros to the right without a decimal, those are not significant. So look at 100 written two ways. And actually, let's throw in a third one just for good measure. Right, here's 100, no decimal. Here's 100 with a decimal. Here's 100, the decimal place and decimal places. In the units, right? This is something like a beaker. The lack of a decimal tells me, hey, I'm really not sure if that's 100, it could be 99, it could be 97, it could be 103. All I'm confident of is that it's one, that I could be off. 100 with a decimal says, yes, I know it's 100, but that's where my accuracy stops. And then 100.00, that says, yes, it's 100, and it's 100.00. Those are all actual measurements. Do we see the difference? Again, the zeros are the big ones. They're the ones that give students the most trouble. And it's usually these two rules that do it. Zeros to the right, not significant if there's not a decimal. Zeros to the left, never significant. Ever. That one's easier. Zeros to the right is when things get in trouble. Now, if you're counting, you don't need to worry about sig figs, right? If I said, how many faucets are in this room? Who cares, right? You don't need to have any accuracy and issues there unless you're having some, you know, you can't see it because something's in the way, right? You don't need to use sig figs. Okay, so let's do these as a class. Just shout out. How many sig figs are in this number? Four, right? That's four sig figs. How many are in this one? That one's four as well. How many are in this one? Three. And how many are in this one? Four. Why is it not six? Because these to the left and this one too are all placeholders. All right, let's do these. How many sig figs are in A? 3 sig figs, right? Because those are all non-zero digits. How many sig figs are in B? How many?
4.
4, right? Those are all 4, because that 0 is significant because it's in between non-zeros. How many sig figs are in C? 3, good. These are placeholders. You can imagine that as an underscore. How many are in D? Be careful. 4, it's 4. Excuse me. And why are these significant? That decimal is telling me, hey, that's an actual measurement. So like I said, the zeros to the right are when things get a little heavier. You have to look at the decimal. Is there a decimal or is there not a decimal? E, how many sig figs are in E? 1, right? Why? How come this zero doesn't count? There's no decimal. The decimal is what makes it count. How many are in F? How many are in F?
4.
Right. This zero to the right, never significant. Okay, so again, the purpose of sig figs is to tell the reader, what did I use to make my measurement? And the sig figs directly come from the piece of equipment you use. Right? I mean, this is just kind of how a rational person thinks. If you hear something on the news, you hear someone say something, oh, blah, 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 blah happened, right? You want to question your source. You're like, where did you hear that? Right? The same thing's here. You want to look at the source. The source tells you the credibility. So if this is not very accurately measured, it's not a very credible result. And so when we make measurements in lab, we don't just make a measurement and say, hey, look at that neat measurement, right? We take a measurement and then we do something with it. We're multiplying, we're dividing, we're subtracting, we're adding, right? We're doing something with the measurements we make. We don't just make them and go, well, I'm done, right? We have to do something with it. And so the purpose of the sig fig rules is to govern the accuracy of a produced result. In other words, if I'm dividing two numbers, one number is really well measured and one of them is really lousy, my final answer is going to be lousy, right? Because I have to be as accurate as my worst measurement. And that's what sig fig rules ensure, that the accuracy of a computation is as accurate as the worst measurement. Now we have to break it down for addition and subtraction versus multiplying and dividing. And then there are actually different sig fig rules for logarithms, and we'll get into them when we start talking about logarithms. But for now, adding and subtracting. We just do our arithmetic as we normally would, and then we round our final answer to the least number of decimal places. So I punch it into my calculator, just like I normally would, nothing new there. And then what I do is I round my final answer based on the number of decimal places. 2 versus 3. Which one's more accurate? Well, these two are more accurate, right? But this one's less accurate. So my final answer is only as good as my worst measurement. So that means my final answer gets rounded to 2 decimal places. Does this make sense? Adding and subtracting, you just round to the least number of decimal places. Here's one involving subtraction. Which measurement is my worst? It's the 20.1, right? 2 versus 1 versus 2. So I round to my final answer. There shouldn't be a 1 there. That 1 needs to go away. Because if I'm subtracting, there shouldn't be a 120. It should just be 20.2. So that's a typo on my part. Fix that real quick. Make sense? So we go by decimal places when we're adding and subtracting. Now we multiply and divide, the sig fig rules are different because a small error gets propagated a lot faster when you multiply and divide, right? So when we multiply and divide, we punch it into our calculator just like normal. And then we round to the least number of total sig figs. Total sig figs. because a small error rapidly, rapidly increases when I'm multiplying and dividing. So here's an example. 1.4 times 8.011. Okay, this number has two sig figs. Is it very accurate? Two sig figs? Not really, right? This one's got four sig figs. Is that one pretty accurate? Yeah, it is. So when I punch this into my calculator, that's what my calculator spits out. My final answer, if I wrote this, that's saying that my final answer is more accurate than even my best measurement, right? Your final answer can never be more accurate than the measurement it came from, okay? So how should this be rounded? It should be rounded to two sig figs, right? So what would that round to? Close. Two sig figs, it would just be 11, right? You'd lose all those decimal places because this is not a very accurate measurement, right? Two sig figs, four sig figs. So my final answer can only have two sig figs. See? All that gets gone. And that's the penalty you pay for making a lousy measurement, right? If you do one of your measurements really great and your other one really stinks, right? The penalty is the final answer's accuracy reflects that. You can't have a more accurate computed value than the values that you were computing. Does this make sense? Let's do one with division. Okay, so here the chemist was being a little better. Four sig figs versus five. So how many sig figs will be in my final answer? This one has four, this one has five. So four, right? So my final answer has four sig figs in it. Again, this zero is insignificant, and this zero is as well. Make sense? Ready to try some for yourself? That's the format, right? I show you, then you try. Anyone need me to leave it here any longer? Okay, I'll go back over this one in a minute. I'm gonna do that one later too. I wanted to get to some practicing. So you do these on your own. You can talk to somebody if you want. You may use your calculator. Round your final answer to the appropriate number of sig figs.